And so through the science and math courses that I took, that developed the critical thinking skills so that I can apply it to world issues.
That's great. And you heard Dr. Kine talk about the basis for science is asking why. Mm-hmm. So you're speaking to that directly. How about others? Anyone have anything to add to that? Why do you think STEM education benefits girls who don't pursue STEM careers?
Well, personally for me, I'm pretty sure I'm not going to be pursuing STEM careers, but like I've said, I'm thankful for the STEM classes that I've taken because they've given me everything that I need to know, like the critical thinking, like Patricia mentioned, planning. So for my gold award, you have to know like all the logistics of it and step-by-step processes of what you're going to do, and math has taught me how to do that and just to organize my thoughts. Also, taking a STEM class, more of the technology side of it, I've taken media productions, and that has actually shown me my passion. I've found my passion through that, and if I weren't forced to take that class either, I probably wouldn't have ever realized like that's what I want to do. So like I've said, STEM has opened my eyes to another side of things, and yeah.
That's great, thank you. Your mom is not forcing you, she's just helping to pave your way. Just saying. So you guys have all already achieved a lot of success. I mean, all four of you have, clearly. And you've talked a little bit about this, but continue to talk a little more on how you've used STEM skills in your life so far. Ayana, you want to start?
Yeah, I'll start with this one. So I'll be talking specifically to science research, which is actually the opposite of science classes. But if someone, it's completely opposite.
Kind of sad in itself.
But we're working on it. Play is coming. But if someone goes into research, on the surface it looks like they're learning very, very specific skills. You're studying some pathway in a cell that only a few people know about. But there's a much broader set of transferable skills that everyone gets. What's always tossed around is that doing research teaches you how to think, and it is true. So if I am designing an assay, like an experiment, and it doesn't work the first 15 times, you get very good at figuring out how to predict every single outcome, how to account for them, how to control each aspect and understand the processes and manage a project. There's every kind of skill that you need in really in everything. I can't think of something it does not apply to.
That's great. Anything to add?
I think it's like big on like group work because especially in high school, the labs that we do, you can't do it by yourself, you know, and like we write lab reports, and that's kind of like when you start getting into like the gist of things. It's not so much like, oh, let's do an experiment about, you know, my potato can light up a light bulb or something that I've done in middle school. And that, like, you really need to learn how to work with other people, and you really learn to appreciate other people's skills, you know. Like, I'm not good at doing this, you know, so you have your friend help you. It's very cooperative, and it really helps you in your other classes, too, especially since, like, you've had this experience and you know, like, everyone has their, like, their strengths and their weaknesses, and you kind of learn from everybody.
It's great. And then, Patricia, in your Save the Kelp work, you must have used a scientific approach, right?
Well, the project was all about environmental science, so there was, on a literal level, lots of talking. Even today, still, will explain kelp and marine science to people, but just developing a plan for a project, organizing a structure, you use logic.
Right.
If you want to have the best plan possible. And
absolutely.
So all those techniques, algebra, whatever, you kind of, in mapping out a plan, you can use those skills.
Right, exactly. So what would have made STEM more appealing in school?
Making learning more active, so it's not like watching a TV, but it's actually an activity. People learn the material, especially women minorities. Everyone improves, but it improves more for some groups. We need that. We also need to connect what we learn to the real world. Why would we want to understand how some random chemicals bond? No one cares until they understand maybe how that affects their food or their products they use or just the world in general. We need to know why we're learning it, and that will also inspire projects, because once people have an idea, they own that information and they're inspired to go do something with it.
That's great. Charlene, you want to add to that?
Yeah, I definitely agree with her, more hands-on. I worked with like a really nice summer program, a science program called Team Science, and it does actually focus on girls. They definitely emphasize like 50-50, like at least like half and half. And the kids really enjoy, I mean, maybe for everyone here, it's sounds kind of childish, but you know, the vinegar and baking soda volcanoes, you know, everyone really likes those. So it's things like that where after they get to see the experiment in action, then they start to think like, you know, like, why is this happening? This is really cool. Versus the other way around where people are like, oh, and electricity and magnets, parallel circuits, you know, that's not something that you really want to hear, like being lectured to at the age of 8. So definitely more hands-on experiments and getting kids involved at a younger age.
Patricia, how about you?
Field experience, same answer.
Hands-on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And being able to get dirty, especially if you can be outside.
Mm-hmm.
It's key.
Makes a big difference.
Hands-on, definitely. I walk into physics and I find out we're doing a lab, I get so excited because it's so much better than just listening to a lecture, copying down notes, and working out problems. I'm a visual learner, so when we're able to do labs and hands-on work and I see something happen, like I can see like how everything works and I go, aha, like that's how it works. And it makes everything click within me. And for example, when I took a CLA class, freshman year, I forgot, I'm sorry what it stands for actually, but we had to, we worked with breadboards and we had to connect wires together and make little LED lights light up. And I struggled through that class, but every single time the light would light up, I would get so happy and feel so accomplished. And it really gave me a deeper understanding of everything, like just computers and how they work, and I'm thankful for that.
That's great, thank you. So we have this amazing group of 150 community influencers here today. This is your chance now to lean in and reach back and help them understand how can the next generations coming up benefit. So how can these community leaders help girls stay engaged in STEM? Charlene, why don't you start?
I think one of the biggest things, like I said earlier, is definitely the families. Like, get your children or, you know, people that you know, get them involved in elementary school. Don't wait until they think they have an idea of what they want to do when they grow up. Because it's great that we're focusing on, like, middle school and high school students when they're starting to really decide, like, this is what I want to do in college. But if you get that seed planted very early on, it'll stay with them the entire time, and then they'll start to think like, you know, like this is what I want to do. So I think like science programs in the summer are great, like after school programs, like the ones that like run like Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and like Tuesday, Thursdays after school for a couple hours, especially if it's like building things or like experimenting, things like that. I think that's very important.
Great, thank you. Patricia?
Providing opportunities for us to see STEM at work in the real world, because in the classroom it often feels limited and we don't always see that application of how it really changes us and can address things that we do see as mattering to us on a more practical level. And then we realize, oh shoot, STEM matters a lot. And connecting with girls so that they have role models, so that they see you, they see how successful you are, and they go, wow, you're really cool, I want to be like you. And then allowing them a chance to try it for themselves. And tutoring.
Yeah.
Having someone that can help you, because it's really encouraging to have someone who will sit and talk with you and dialogue and answer questions and help encourage that critical thinking process, because it's a lonely island when you try to do it alone.
And it is hard. And you aren't born knowing all of what you need to know. So, Liza, how about you?
So along those lines, I think, for one, internships. I know a lot of you may be a little
lobbying.
I think a lot of you may be a little uneasy about letting a 16-year-old or somebody around that age who's a minor work in your workplace. But for my school, we have, if you're in the tech program, you have to have an internship 150 hours unpaid over the summer. And I know from my experience, myself and a lot of my friends, we have been rejected from so many places that we want to help. And even, please, I'm pleading that you just give us a chance, not necessarily for the internship, but for just even an interview, just so you can see if we can contribute to you. And I'm telling you, you would be surprised at how much young people can do, because a lot of us just want to learn from you and contribute to you from what we already know. Also, for everyone, I think, just telling people, telling students and your own family members about your careers if you are in STEM, whether or not you are, just encouraging people to, or inspiring people to take on what you're doing, you know, maybe giving them some ideas. Because I know my math teacher last year had a poster in his classroom, and it said, like, all of the things you can do with a math major. And there were, like, 1,000 things. And I would read it every day and be like, wow, you could do that too, and that too. And, like, I would just discover something every day, and I was amazed with how much you can do. So just talking to people, inspiring younger generation.
Thank you. Thank you. Ayana.
I think there's things that we can do not to bring women into STEM, but to stop them from leaving STEM. And this is something actually that I don't think it's specific to STEM. I think there's some things that affect all women. No matter what the girl goes into, it'll help her, which is the best scenario, because you know it'll have an effect. And that is preparing them to challenge themselves and to fail. In science especially, it is a process of failing successfully, if that makes any sense. You make mistakes, you learn from them, you go forward. And we need to teach them that it's not about being perfect. It's about really pushing the boundaries of what you can do. And I think what you can all do is facilitate that process, both by teaching them that that's okay, that they should be challenged and struggling, and also by giving them opportunities to do that in a structured, supported environment.
Thank you. That's great. And with every failing, there's learning and growth, right?
Especially with the failings.
That's right.
So, girls, thank you again. What a great, great job. Thank you.
It's seeing this packed room and seeing that 25% of you are men, and the level of leadership we have in this room and the engagement you had during the whole morning, but during the table exercise, it gives me chills. I'm so thrilled by that, because we can really make a difference in thousands of girls' lives on a daily basis. So we want to end with one more thing, and it's a very inspiring message from Ayana, who was up here earlier, about her journey so far into a career of STEM. I've had an opportunity to watch Ayana develop and blossom throughout her Girl Scout years, from a curious girl to a gracious and accomplished young woman of 23. Joining her today are her parents, Peter and Sloan, who continues to be, Sloan, who continues to be a Girl Scout volunteer, and Ayana's younger sister, Olivia, who's a Girl Scout cadet. They've all been instrumental in the path that Ayana has chosen. This is a very unassuming family, and it took some pressure and persuasion from me for Ayana to focus her comments on her personal experiences. But I thought it was important to bring to life everything you've heard about the importance of girls continuing their STEM education through one girl's story. I hope you'll be inspired to take action when you leave here today. Please join me in welcoming Ayana back to the stage.
First, before I start, thank you so much, everyone, for all those comments going around the tables. I learn about these things and talk about these things on a daily basis as women in STEM, but it's not common to see other people, and people, especially people with influence in the community, also agreeing with this and really standing behind these issues. It really does mean a lot. And for Mother's Day, this is my mother and I at a day camp that I started. And I should also add that my dad was somewhere there doing tons of work behind the scenes. So it's the whole family camp. We all go. So I discovered in college that my enthusiasm for topics like parasites and plagues is rather rare. This revelation came sometime between my class on plagues since the 1600s, which was one of my favorite classes, and a very enthusiastic Facebook post about intestinal bacterial communities, to which I received a very strong ew from all of my friends. This, I hear, is actually a problem for a lot of researchers, because no matter how excited we are that our fungus turned pink or our freshly cloned bacteria now glow, no one wants to see the pictures. Sometimes I do wonder how I became someone with both the interest and, frankly, the lack of embarrassment necessary to pursue a degree in microbiology. Thankfully, my family is there, as always, with the answers. Growing up with two nurses as parents makes for a very interesting childhood. Like most families, we often talked about my parents' work over dinner. For us, that meant a lively discussion on the latest stabbing, how to start an IV, or just, you know, a flu epidemic, nothing big. I soon understood how to treat small wounds and properly dose household medications, but I was determined to branch out. In fact, I remember repeatedly telling my parents that I was never going into medicine. There was just one flaw with this medicine-free future that I imagined. I was fascinated by our discussions. I mean, who wouldn't want to learn how to treat emergency room traumas over dinner? So I think my family always knew that I was going to give in and go into STEM anyways. At one point, my grandfather introduced me to field biology research. As volunteers, our job was to follow around a family of meerkats, recording everything they ate. In other words, we kept diet journals for a fuzzy, burrowing family of 15. After genuinely enjoying a few weeks deciphering the sound of chewed up grubs from chewed up spiders based on crunch tone and length, you'd think a career in biology would be fairly easy to predict. However, by this time, I was in high school and soaking up everything from choir to Spanish to community organizing. School became twice as interesting overnight as both topics and teaching methods broadened. I especially loved classes that allowed curiosity and demonstrated connections between class content and the real world. For example, in physics, we learned about projectile motion by theoretically firing our teacher's cat, Dinky, into the air. Despite feeling slightly sorry for this imaginary cat, it was really hard not to smile at quiz questions about all of this cat's misadventures. At the same time, history became the most trashy soap opera I had ever heard, as narrated by an outstanding teacher, while environmental studies became a window into the modern global issues and solutions. Even better, high school encouraged action. I could learn about the harm of chemical fertilizers and then go and encourage my school to buy a composter, or I could create a training program for incoming freshmen as they tried their first high school service projects. I could even sell cookies to help fund outdoor sporting trips like dog sledding and canoeing with Girl Scouts. Outside of school, Girl Scouts offered a completely different set of opportunities. The adults in Girl Scouts, like my family, didn't treat me like a high school girl. Rather, they presented me with opportunities and with challenges. With GSOC, I discovered an interest in corporate governance as an advisor for the board and the satisfaction of public speaking as part of a girl advocacy patrol. I discovered the larger workings of a national NGO when I served as a delegate at the National GSUSA Convention. That experience of standing on a floor of thousands of other delegates taught me the importance of just standing up and speaking, regardless of any nerves. My Girl Scout experience culminated when I established a community day camp, the same one you see up here. And I also was honored at that time with an Outstanding Senior Girl Scout Award. The camp that I started was an educational program to introduce girls to the outdoors and to teach them practical skills, something which I saw was often lacking. Over the last 6 years, the camp has evolved to provide novel educational opportunities, personal growth, and leadership development to hundreds of Orange County girls, as well as expanding to provide experiences for leadership for the young women who volunteer at our camp. Shortly after my third year of camp, I moved across the country to go to Yale, and I was stunned. Yale was vibrant and completely overwhelming. I could take classes like Women's Health in India or an entire class on weather patterns. I could also sign up for 8 different extracurricular activities and meet students from around the world, including a few other Girl Scouts. On one hand, this became a time to expand my interests and my abilities, but suddenly the limit was not the opportunities, it was me. Even if I was gaining experiences, I felt more normal and more unremarkable than ever. Did I belong there? How do you choose your life goals and path when everything interests you? Most of the time, I felt more at home at Yale than anywhere. And the rest of the times, I relied very heavily on my past experiences and my home community to remind myself that I did belong at Yale. Classes and life away from home became easier, but it was the struggle to find a single path that actually led to some of my most remarkable experiences. My freshman summer, I interned at a children's hospice in Uganda. I came prepared to work in a giant, orderly, American-style hospital. Instead, I found a one-room cancer ward with over 40 beds and children from every region of the country. Ironically, and rather painfully, I discovered that the children received better treatment after going on palliative care. The hospice could have formed chemotherapy and morphine, and the hospital could not. These children were also not what I expected. I knew these children were very ill, terminally ill, and I expected them to act like it. But instead, they sprinted and played tag on crutches, they played games in bed, and really, they act just like any other child. And they were wonderful children, made more resilient and more responsible by necessity. I started developing a library at the hospice, since many of the children's families could not afford school. And I was stunned. These children were like little sponges, each with ambitions and talents to share, but really no way to go to school or to reach the world. I was truly in awe of them, but also slightly disturbed. I had never seen poverty both so severe and so accepted, and I had never realized how much talent the world was losing by abandoning these children. Even if I never pursue a career in public health or return to Uganda, that experience permanently complicated my view of the world. The following year, after I had actually moved away from science, I decided to take one last STEM class. It was just for fun and I couldn't resist. This class, Rainforest Expedition and Lab, was famous on campus because it took students to Ecuador for field biology research. Each spring, a small cohort of students learned all about plants, fungi, and traditional Ecuadorian uses of plants. Then we would create independent research projects that we could transfer to another lab at Yale. This was my first time pursuing research, and I was hooked. I had recently become interested in multi-drug-resistant bacteria, so I planned a project where I could find chemicals to kill these superbugs. I pitched my idea to a professor and joined a microbiology lab. Then came the fun part, the field biology research, or as we fondly called it in our class, our professor's annual vacation. The entire class flew to Ecuador over spring break to do one very odd thing. We rode riverboats, we trekked through cloud forests, and braved very large insects, all to find the perfect plant clippings. At one point, I remember harvesting this particularly spiny nettle, which seemed like a very good idea, until later, when I sat in a hospital lobby struggling to perfectly flatten and display this very, very spiky trophy, and also trying to keep my hands intact. Eventually, the trekking and plant collecting did pay off when we returned home and collected what we really wanted. You see, every plant has fungi, like the fuzzy mold we see in bread, that grow inside the plant tissues. So as soon as we were back at Yale, I started opening and growing fungi out of these plants. I like to think of this as fungus farming, and it's a habit that continues for me to this day. As the fungi grow, they produce interesting chemicals such as penicillin. Because of this, I grow fungi, remove the extra chemicals that they produce, and then check if any of these chemicals are antibiotics. Research allowed me to do tangible work and required critical thinking, both of which were often lacking among actual science classes. Research also taught me how to manage a project, predict and adjust for outcomes, and think critically in the moment. When I finally took a break from research this last summer,
it was surprisingly difficult to leave my project behind. I had just graduated from Yale with a research intensive degree in molecular, cellular, and developmental biology, and decided to reset my life by hiking the Camino de Santiago. I should mention that I am not a spontaneous person. I am a planner. However, on this trip, all I could plan were the flights and the things I put in my backpack. Each day, my friend and I would hike through towns and small roads until we reached an albergue, or a hostel, where we would stay the night. We walked from the French Pyrenees to the Atlantic Ocean, and along the way, I noticed that everything simplified on the trail as I slowly settled into a routine of hiking, cooking, and just finding a place to sleep. By pushing my limits of comfort, I soon came to enjoy the freedom of walking one day at a time. And in this time after college, that ability to cope with uncertainty or even enjoy a part of it has been very, very important. I have been very fortunate to find a place within STEM, but as a member of the STEM community, I also feel that we are far overdue for change in STEM. My microbiology professor once warned that you will get the answers you ask for. In science, we learn to ask research questions very carefully, but we are rarely asked to take that skill outside of the lab. I think it is time to reassess what we want from STEM fields and to reconsider who we should include in STEM. In my new position with Yale Center for Scientific Teaching, I have discovered that a lot of people feel exactly the same way about this issue. Across the country, programs are springing up to train professors, better engage students, and devise ways to make STEM more inclusive. I am proud to be joining this group of people as I manage a team of professors and researchers to evaluate the effects of professor training programs on classroom environment and student choices. We all have an opportunity to use this momentum, the momentum we've been seeing in this room today, and finally reach gender equity in science. STEM is the way that we learn about our world, and it is also the mechanism by which we design our future. It is time to ensure that we have today's young women designing that future.
Besides the fact that Ayana is amazing, I just have one last thing to say about that, and that is don't ever underestimate the power of a girl. We find that all the time.